Hello everyone, I am Dr. Mazhar Ali and I welcome you back to our course Introduction to Artificial Intelligence. Today we are going to discuss the unsupervised learning. So unsupervised learning happens when we have data without any additional feedback, without variables. So in the supervised learning case, all of our data had variables. We labeled a data point with whether that was a rainy day or not rainy day. And using those labels, we were able to infer what the pattern was. Where we labeled data as a counterfeit banknote or not a counterfeit. And using those labels, we were able to draw inferences and patterns to figure out what does a banknote looks like versus not. The concept of clustering came two earlier, John Sinow, a London-based physician, when the cholera epidemic came in the world, and after calculating the patients and identifying the patients, John Sinow, a London-based physician, plotted the cases of cholera or the cholera deaths on a map during an outbreak in the 1850s. So he clustered the areas and identifies the cases, and he shown the areas according to cases. So he made the clusters of the cases according to areas. That was definitely the identification of the cases as well as the treatment of the cases as well. However, the concept of clusters came being into 1850s by the John Sinow, a London-based physician. Unsupervised learning is a machine learning technique where you do not need to supervise the model. Like in the supervised learning, we train the model for this. We train the model on the basis of labeled data. So instead, you need to allow the model to work on its own to discover information in the unsupervised learning. Means unsupervised learning is where you only have input data X and no corresponding output variables, likewise in the supervised learning. The goal of unsupervised learning is to model the underlying structure or distribution in the data in order to learn more about the data. Therefore, unsupervised learning algorithms allow you to perform more complex processing tasks compared to unsupervised learning. So it finds all kinds of unknown patterns in data. It helps the data analyst to find features that can be useful for categorization. So it is easier to get unlabeled data from a computer than labeled data, which needs manual intervention. Therefore, the most common unsupervised learning method is a cluster analysis, which is used for exploratory data analysis to find hidden patterns or grouping available in the data. In unsupervised learning, we don't have any access to any of those labels, but we still would like to learn some of those patterns. And one of the tasks that you might want to perform in unsupervised learning is something like clustering, like this one. Where clustering is just the task of given some set of objects organized into distinct clusters, groups of objects that are similar to one another. So even if you look here, here the objects are mixed. What type of the objects are mixed, and you do not separate them? But if you look here in the other picture, that is clustered. So here you may identify the different varieties of the objects by the color, by the type. So this is the example of cluster, since here the data was mixed. So in the real world, you may get the mixed data. However, through the programming, through the model, you may separate the data by their scope, by their standard gene and so on, or any type, you may separate them. Now, why clustering? It's a good question. Why clustering? So grouping similar entities together helps profiles the attributes of different groups. In other words, this will give us insight into the underlying patterns of different groups. So there are many applications of grouping unlabeled data. For example, you can identify different group segments, as we saw in the previous slide. If you look here, there are different group segments of the items or the objects, or even you may analyze the customers as well. So there may be the different groups of or segments of the customers and even the market. So market each group in a different way to maximize the revenue. So and another example is the grouping documents together which belong to similar topics as etc. So clustering is also used to reduce the dimensionality of the data when you are dealing with the copious number of variables, and it's a very important process. Clustering is a very important process to separate, to differentiate the different types of data on basis of their identification and relations and scope as well. For example, you are, as I told you example, if you are going in a market, though the people are of same type by their shape, but they are of their different thinking, and customer mind is different in the market. So you may make the clusters of those people or those customers in the market. Even the companies are making the clusters of the customers according to their product and demand, as well as according to supply. There are lots of applications for clustering. It comes up in the genetic research where you might have a whole bunch of different genes and you want to cluster them into similar genes if you are trying to analyze it across a population or across a species. And it comes up in an image if you want to take all the pixels of an image. So cluster them into different parts of the image. Therefore, clustering is also very good for the image segmentation, genetic research, and it is very good in market research. If you want to divide your customers or your consumers into different groups, so you know which groups to target with the certain types of product advertisements for, and a number of other contexts as well in which clustering can be very applicable. So it depends on the organizations and the programmers and data analysts that for what purpose they are going to cluster the data. As I just tell you, the genetic, for example, genetic purpose, image segmentations, marketing, even the medical imaging, you may, if you want to identify the cancer, pneumonia, and other diseases from the X-ray, MRI, or CT scan, you want to identify the brain tumor, so on, you may make the clusters and identify the disease. Even the social network analysis, you may done that what type of the groups are there on the social media, or what type of the social networks are here, and what type of mentality or other working objects of those social networks. So you may analyze on the basis of clustering. Sorry. One technique for clustering is an algorithm known as the K-means. K-means, you may call it the K-means clustering. And what K-means clustering is going to do, it is going to divide all of our data points into K different clusters. K different cluster means you may define the number of clusters. Either you required 3 clusters, 8 clusters, 10 clusters, 2 clusters, and any type. So K is basically the number what you want to assign. So k-means is an iterative clustering algorithm that helps you to find the highest value for every iteration. Initially, the desired number of clusters is selected. So in this clustering method, you need to cluster the data points into k groups, a larger group, k means similar groups with a more granularity in the same way. So a lower k means a larger group with less granularity as well. The output of the algorithm is a group of labels. It assigns data point to one of the k groups. So in a k means clustering, each group is defined by the creating a centroid for each group, means center for the each group or each cluster. So centroids are like the heart of the cluster, which captures the points closest to them and add them to the cluster. So now we are going to define the cluster by its center, the middle of the cluster, and then assign points to that cluster based on which center is the closest to that point. And I'll show you an example of that now. However, the k-means is basically is an iterative clustering algorithm which helps you to find the highest value for every iteration. So k-mean, basically what is the working process of the k-mean? So it starts with the k as the input, which is how many clusters you want to find. As I told you in the previous slide, is in the k you have to assign the value and place k centroid in a random locations in your space. So the first step now, using the Euclidean distance between data points and centroids, assign each data point to the cluster which is close to it. So Euclidean function is used for the distances measuring, and recalculate the cluster centers as a mean of the data points assigned to it. Repeat 1 and 2 means these two functions, because I told you already that k means is an iterative algorithm. So after performing these two functions, you have to repeat these two functions until no further changes occurs. So now you might be thinking that how do I really decide the value of k in the first step? So let's see. I will give you the example, and you will understand that how we perform the k means. So if you look here, there are three clusters, 1, 2, 3, and these are in a raw form. Though these are not mixed, however, but there is no centroid or no central point in this form. So here, for example, I have a whole bunch of unlabeled data. Even you look here, is that it's a totally the unlabeled data, just various data points. If you look here, various data points are that are in some sort of graphical space, and I would like to group them into different clusters. So I want to assign three clusters to this group as they are looking in three formats, and you have to choose how many clusters you want in the k-means. Definitely I am going for divide the this group of data into three clusters, but it depend on you how many clusters you want. So if you look at this slide, and I'll just start by randomly picking some places to put the centers of those clusters. And that may be I have a blue cluster. Like if you look here, this is the blue cluster, and this is the red cluster, and this is a green cluster. So there are three clusters. However, these are not centroid. Center points are away from these clusters. So and I'm if you look here, so I'm going to start with the centers of those clusters just being in these three locations here. These are one vocation, second vocation, third vocation. So what K-means cluster tells us to do is, once I have the centers of the clusters, assign every point to a cluster based on which cluster center it is close to. So we end up with something like this, where all of these points are closer to the bilu. If you look here, almost a bilu except this one. This was away from the bilu. And then any other cluster center as well. So all of these points here are closer to a green cluster. If you look here, though these are some away, so center should be here. It would be fine. And if you look here at the red should be here. So now look. So these two points plus these means these points or the this one points over here. So those are all these points. However, if you look at these points, these all points are closest to the. These points are closest to red, and these are closest to blue, and these are closest to green. So it seems like in this red cluster, these points are kind of a far point. If you look here, this is looks far apart. So in this green, even if you look cluster, these points are kind of far apart. So we did so without any access to some labels. However, we performed manual, so it gives a good result. So let's take a look at how we could go about classifying data using the K-means algorithm with the Python. So how we practically perform the clusters or the data. So we are going to open the Python environment, and we will look here. So I've already set the program here, already set the program. So as always, we need to start by importing the required libraries. So I imported some libraries like the NumPy, Pandas, and Matplot library. So what is NumPy? Basically, NumPy is a library for the Python program language, adding support for large multi-dimensional arrays and matrices, along with a large collection of high-level mathematical functions to operate on these arrays. So this is a very good library of the Python for calculating the mathematical and the machine learning processes. Another is Pandas. So Pandas is a fast, powerful, flexible, and easy to use open source data analysis and manipulation tool. So built on top of the Python programming languages, or even Pandas is a, you may call it a soft library written for the Python programming language for data manipulation and analysis. So in particular, it offers data structures and operations for manipulating numerical labels and time series. Another library is Matplot library. So Matplot library or Matplotlib is a plotting library for the Python programming language, and it is a numerical mathematics extensions NumPy, and it provides an object-oriented API for embedding plots into applications. So we use always PyPlot with the Matplot. So PyPlot is a collection of command style functions that make the Matplot lib work. So we just shift enter this these libraries and come to the here we have two variables x and y. So we are going to make our own data set here. So make the blob, and we have taken this data. There are 300 samples with some center points and cluster and so on. So we will execute this query to generate some the scatter the data. So we just enter, and then we are working on the k means. So here we are using the elbow method. Now what is elbow method? So elbow method runs k means clustering on the data set for a range of values for k, say from 1 to 10 for example. And then for each value of k, computes an average score for all clusters. So by default, the distortion score is computed the sum of square distance from each point to its assigned centers. So even the even though we already know the optimal number of clusters, so I figure out we could still benefit from determining it using the elbow method. So to get the values used in the graph, we train multiple models using a different numbers of clusters and storing the value of the interior property. So means interior property means within the cluster sum of squares. So most commonly called it is WCSS. So just I shift into this one. So you look here. This is the elbow method. The elbow method is generated. This is the x-axis and the xy. And here the what I told you, WCSS, it stands for within cluster sum of squares. That what is the sum of squares within a cluster every time. So an ideal way to figure out the right number of clusters would be to calculate the within cluster sum of squares or the WCSS. So WCSS is the sum of squares of the distances of each data point in all clusters to their respective centroids. So now we are going to make the clusters separate with the centroids. So we just enter here. This is the k means algorithm. If you look here, these are the k means algorithm. So I just shift enter this code, and to look here, is the k means so look here at the result and the coding means we categorize the data using the optimum number of clusters. If you look here, the value of cluster is 4. So the optimum number of cluster is 4. If you want to extend, you may extend here, but that's 5, 6 and so on. So we determined in the last step that k means plus ensures that you get don't fall into the random initialization trap. So this is the basically result of our clusters. We took the data and made our own data set. 300 samples of data, and we make the 4 clusters, and we distance the distance as well, and we got 4 clusters. If you look here, red is the center point of all these clusters. So these are a different type of the data, and this is their center point. So now we will go for other types of the unsupervised learning. So the another type of the unsupervised learning is the hierarchical clustering technique. It is one of the popular clustering technique in the machine learning. So this clustering technique is divided into two types: agglomerative hierarchical clustering technique and divisive hierarchical clustering technique. So therefore, the hierarchical clustering technique is basically an algorithm which builds a hierarchy of clusters, and it begins with all the data which is assigned to a cluster of their own. So in the agglomerative technique, initially each data point is considered as an individual cluster. Each data is considered as an individual cluster in the agglomerative technique. It each iteration, the similar clusters merge with other clusters until one cluster of k clusters are formed. So key operation is the basically computation of the proximity of two clusters, that how much these clusters are close to each other. There may be a lot of data, but this technique finds the closest clusters. Therefore, it is a type of a hierarchical clustering algorithm where each individual, as I told you, element to be clustered is in its own cluster. And another type of the hierarchical clustering technique is a divisive. So it is a different than the agglomerative technique. Since that, if we look at the divisive hierarchical technique, the divisive hierarchical technique clustering technique is basically not much used in the real world as the agglomerative technique is used. So I will give you a brief of the divisive hierarchical clustering technique. In simple words, we can say that the divisive hierarchical clustering is exactly the opposite of the agglomerative hierarchical clustering. In divisive hierarchical clustering, we consider all the data points as a single cluster, since in the agglomerative technique, we consider all the data cluster separate and independent cluster. So it's a big difference between these two techniques. And in each iteration, we separate the data point in divisive. What happened in divisive hierarchical clustering? In each iteration, we separate the data points from the cluster, so which are not similar. And each data point which is separated is considered as an individual cluster. Otherwise, this technique find all the data as a single cluster. But when it is separated by the process, then it is considered as an individual cluster. So this is a different between the agglomerative technique and the divisive technique. So now we are going to again to Python to do some coding for the hierarchical technique, that how hierarchical technique works and how the dendrograph is created. Again, we will go here. So if you look here, suppose we have a collection of data points represented by a NumPy array. We imported NumPy, and I told you what is the NumPy. So for example, if you look here, this is the data. This is the different type of the data we have taken. And we process it. So again, let's plot the above data, what we saw. So to do execute the code, for example, this is the code. And this is the code. This is a label we arrange from 1 to 11 because plot definitely it figures out. So if we execute it, so this is the data. If you find here in the hierarchical techniques, there are 10 clusters and each point is a separate cluster. So this is a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 on the lower side. On the upper side, again, you see there are 5 data clusters. And what we got it in hierarchical techniques, each cluster is considered as a separate or independent cluster. So if you look here, each point is counted or considered as a separate point. And let's name the this graph. So for example, we are calling it a graph one in this process. And if you remember, the script above draws the data points in the X numpy array and label data points from 1 to 10. It means so in the image you will see the plot, but you that is generated from this code. If you look here, so all the 10 clusters are here. So we given graph one name to this graph. It can be seen that the data points from two clusters, first at the bottom left, consisting of points 1 to 5 on the below side. If you look here, and there are 1 to 5 clusters, while the second at the top right, there are 6 to 10. So 5 clusters are in each side. However, in the real world, we may have thousands of data points in many more than two dimensions. So in that case, it would not be possible to spot clusters with the naked eye. So this is why clustering algorithms have been developed. So coming back to the use of dendrogram in the hierarchical clustering, let's draw the dendrograms for our data points. Dendrograms are used for the clustering techniques, mostly for the hierarchical techniques. So we will use the SciPy libraries for that purpose and execute the code for the result. So we just SciPy cluster, and it is, as I told you, it is used for the hierarchical technique. So we code some for the to draw the dendrogram. So if when we execute this data, this code, for example, shift enter, and we will get result. So dendrogram is here. If you look here, this is a dendrogram. So so the algorithm starts by finding the two points that are closest to each other based on Euclidean distance. And if we look back at a graph one, we can see that points 2 and 3 are closest to each other. Even if you look here, these two points are very much close to each other. And therefore, in graph two, dendrograph is generated by joining points 4 with the dendrograph of point 2 and 3. So if look here, so 2 and 3 are very much closed. So this process continues until all the points are joined together to form one big cluster. And dendrogram is a diagram, as I told you, it is a diagram representing a tree. So this diagrammatic representation is a frequent way used in different context in hierarchical clustering. So it illustrates the arrangement of the clusters produced by the corresponding analysis. So all the is in the first graph. If you look 2, 3, and even if you look 7, 8 or more closer, so according to their closeness, the diagram is generated here. So this is a hierarchical the result in form of dendrogram. So it was a lecture on unsupervised learning. So unsupervised learning is a machine learning technique, as I told you earlier, where you do not need to supervise the model, as you are supervising model in the supervised learning. So it helps you to find all kinds of unknown patterns in the data, where in the supervised learning, unknown patterns make problems. So in supervised learning, algorithms are trained using labeled data, while in unsupervised learning, algorithms are used against data that is not labeled. So I discussed color string here in today's lecture. That is the process of grouping similar entities together. The goal of this unsupervised machine learning technique is to find similarities in the data point and group similar data points together. And definitely anomaly detection can discover important data points in your data set, which is useful for finding the fraudulent transaction. Even the color string is very good for spam data and other, which is unknown, which is a mixed data and unknown. So you may use the color string technique and all types of the color string techniques. We could not discuss the all techniques of unsupervised learning. However, we discussed the famous or too much useful techniques in today's lecture. So we will discuss another topic of the artificial intelligence in coming lecture. Take care and establish your and stay home as well.